Hello and welcome to the sixth and the last lecture of this module on critical thinking. Before we start the lecture, I would like you to look at this picture. What do you make of it? The picture has been divided into three: information, knowledge, wisdom. Please contact me at the forum and let us make something of this picture. How does it pertain to critical thinking? Do you think there is a lot of critical thinking involved in it? I would request you to go back to all the points we have discussed before regarding critical thinking and see how this picture fits into the different paradigms of critical thinking. Now, as I had told you in the previous lecture, this lecture will be discussing two case studies very briefly. Maybe you can read more about them. I have given you the link to these case studies. You can find them in the internet and read about them. The first case study pertains to a person called Sam Petrulla. Heard of him? His name is Satyanarayana Gangaram Petrulla. He was the person who brought about the telecom revolution in India in the 1980s, early 1980s. All of you are so used to an STD booth. Even STD booths are passe these days. You all have mobile phones with you. We, when we were students, had a lot of use of the STD booths and the PCOs. Now, do you know who was the person who made this possible in India? It was Sam Petrulla. Now, he was basically a telecom engineer, a man behind India's telecom revolution. He single-handedly almost transformed the complete telecom scenario in India. His focus was primarily on the rural telecom. He helped in digitizing the whole telecom industry and made sure that it was telephone accessibility, not telephone density, which was a focus of innovation. How did he begin this? I'll give you a small extract from an interview which he had given in the television once. Sam Petrulla says, "Once I was in India and staying in a hotel. Interestingly, I saw a few people taking out a funeral of dead phones. I was intrigued that phones did not work in India. I tried to call my wife back at Chicago, but the phone did not work. I told myself, with a little bit of arrogance and a lot of ignorance, that I will fix this. If I would have known about India that I know today, I would not have tried it. Ignorance is a great asset. I told them, we need to digitize our technology, and for that, we don't need to buy it from another country. We have enough talent in our own country." What is very interesting for me here is the statement that what he says here, with a little bit of ignorance and a lot of arrogance, he decided to take up this project of revolutionizing the telecom industry of India. Do you agree that a little bit of ignorance is necessary at times to take up something that is very risky? And sometimes one has to also have the arrogance, the confidence to say, yes, I can do it. And that is exactly what help Sam Petrulla do this job. Now, look at the various questions that were very important for Sam Petrulla at that point. Do you think Sam Petrulla's decision was impulsive? He says one morning he could not access the phone. One morning he could not talk to people. And that is when he decided that a telecom revolution has to be taken up. Do you think it was impulsive? Or was it the outcome of quick and convincing reasoning? What do you think are the reasons for which he decided to do this? What kind of data did he have, technical and social, to take up a decision like this? To take up a project, design a project of this magnitude? And what are the implications he would have considered before starting the project? Suppose I ask you to go back to the points we had done before. The points which are necessary for critical thinking skills in the field of engineering, that is, the purpose of what is done, who is doing it, why, for what purpose, the different points of views which have to be considered, the socio-cultural factors, the thinking of utility, the different assumptions which are there behind taking a decision, the assumptions about the usefulness, the assumptions about the risks, the assumptions about the utility, the available information we have, information about whether people need it, information whether we have the talent sources available, information about whether we have the technology available, and finally the different concepts involved, the inferences which are being made. Can we look at Sam Petruda's project from this perspective? Do you think there were contradictions in this project which he took up? Do you think he made assumptions which were right? What are your views? What are your feelings about the telecom revolution that has happened in India? How do you translate whatever he has told in this slide over here into the whole process of critical thinking? Let us know about it. We can discuss a little more about this in the forum. The other case study I want to take up over here is about a Norwegian city called Rjukan. The pronunciation is Rjukan. Norwegian language pronounces J-U as double O. This is the second case study. The case study which is about a small city in between, in a valley of Norway, which is called Rjukan. The pronunciation is Rjukan because in the Norwegian language, J-U translates to double O. Now this was a town which was basically set up for workers to live in. It was set up by an engineer, by an industrialist who wanted to capture the electricity and set up an hydroelectricity plant which was meant to generate electricity from a 100 meter waterfall in the hills. Now, unfortunately, this was a place which had most of the amenities which are necessary, but which stayed in the shadow for almost half the year. So right from September, mid-September till March beginning, the town would be in shadow. And gradually people would realize that they would have to move further and further away to get a patch of the sun to enjoy a little bit of sunlight. Now if you have lived ever without sunlight, you would know it can be extremely depressing, extremely sad to live in a place which has no sunlight. Now there was one place called, one person called Martin Anderson, and he took it on himself to change the scenario. And high on the mountain, 450 meters above the town, he put three large solar powered computer controlled mirrors which reflected the sunlight down into the city and bathed up the marketplace of the city in sunlight. Now this is what the small report says. In the Norwegian town of Rjukan, a valley surrounded by high mountains, the sun shone for the first time in autumn when Martin Anderson managed to reflect the sunlight from the hills with the help of three large solar powered mirrors. The mirrors are computer controlled. They track the movement of the sun on the hills across the sky and reflect its rays down the market square of the town. Now if you want to read the entire article, very interesting article with lovely pictures, you have it down here in the link. Go to the internet, you can access it very easily. Now this was not an easy decision to take. There were people who opposed this view. This was not an easy task to do also. Like for example, Martin Anderson said, in the municipal office there was not a stamping pad which said money to be given for making mirrors which will reflect the sunlight down into the city. He again had to decide how much of the city had to be lit. There was a choice of lighting up a larger space with diffused sunlight or a smaller space with focused light. And he decided to choose the marketplace where people would generally come for sitting, the elderly would come and chat, people would get their toddlers to bathe in the sun, and that is a place where people generally sit and relax. So he decided to light up that small patch in this whole city to have sunlight. There are other objections also. Like for example, some people thought the money which is being spent on this could have been spent on building a home for the elderly. The recurring cost which this will have might become very difficult for the place, for the city to meet in the coming years. There were these objections. Not that they are not right, they are different viewpoints. But Martin Anderson had a viewpoint also. He made certain assumptions about the needs of people, about the basic need which people have a little sunlight in their lives, and he decided to go ahead with the project. Now, what do you think about the purpose which Martin Anderson had when he made this project? What do you think about the points of view, his and the points of views of others regarding this project? What do you think about the assumptions, the concept, the available information and the inferences? Now, think of these factors and again, come to me in the forum. Let us discuss this case study also and see how critical thinking would have operated to make this project successful. Before we finish, I would like you to have a very close look at this picture, which says, so we want you to do critical, to think critically. So we want you to think critically while you think about thinking critically. A twist, a tongue twister probably, but something which is very important. You are doing critical thinking. You are doing critical thinking. But are you thinking about critical thinking itself critically? Are you conscious about the assumptions behind critical thinking? Are you conscious about the ideological consequences of critical thinking? You have to, because that is critical thinking on critical thinking. In these lectures we have had, in all the lectures, I would like to briefly summarize what we have done in all these six lectures. I have basically introduced you to the concept of critical thinking. I have told you about the different aspects, important aspects of critical thinking. I have basically taken you to mind mapping, a very important tool to promote critical thinking. And finally, we have done a little bit on critical thinking for engineers. Here, I have tried to give you these two case studies and given you the basic factors of critical thinking, which are important in engineering. And with the help of these two case studies, in the following discussions we'll have on the forum, I hope you'll be able to understand, generate more ideas, give us all more ideas about what you think about these case studies and whether critical thinking was used and how it was used in this module. Thank you all. Hope you enjoyed doing this module. Hope to receive some feedback also about how you like the different aspects which have gone into this module. Thank you.